Well, guys, we've been wandering around the church for the last 5 weeks. We've been looking at different things. We've been talking about different aspects, different places that we see in and around the church. And it's an effort to help us to understand what it is that we as North Crossings Church hold in the highest esteem. So those of you, whether you've been here for a total of a week and you don't really understand what's going on around here, or you've been here for 60 years, it is to help us to understand not just where we've been, but where we're going. And so we've talked about places like the cross, and we talked about what it is to follow Jesus, to put Him first and foremost in our lives. We've talked about the altars, we've talked about the offering plates, and how that is about literally giving over everything to God. Understanding that everything we've ever been given was a gift from Him, and about releasing that back and going, all right, I know that I have this car, I know that I have this house, but God, what do You want done with those things? We've talked about places around here. I'm trying to think of where else we've been because I don't have all of my notes in front of me from every week. But the baptistry, yeah, we talked about the baptistry along with feet washing and along with communion and how the waters transformed. Thanks, Ray. We talk about how the waters have transformed from the place the baptistry was sitting here, and how that is not the water that saves us. But it is the water that declares to everyone around us that we identify with the death and burial of Christ, and also with the resurrection as He came out of the grave and beat death and left sin in hell. We understand that and how that translates to the same water that became wine and was used here at the communion table, and how that is to remind us of what Jesus went through. What He was willing to go through for you and I. And we can always sit there and we can wonder, well really, really, do my sins require me to go all the way to death? Well, maybe, maybe not. But we all know of circumstances of people who have been saved from the grips of death for what they have accomplished here on earth, or what they have fallen to here on earth. And so that everyone at every level with every sin imaginable could be covered, Jesus went all the way to the grave. And this is that reminder, the cup of redemption, the body that reminds us of the Word of God and how it came to life here among us, with us. And then we talked about the service, the servant aspect of that, and what it was to wash one another's feet. Last week we talked about we talked about the back door. We talked about what it is to go beyond these walls and to experience life outside of these walls. And what difference are we making out there? And so what we're talking about this week is we're going to go to the Welcome Center. We're going to look at what it is to be celebrating what God does here in this place for us, but also what that calls us to do. And so the Welcome Center is we're going to talk a little bit of Church of God and what it means to be part of the Church of God Reformation movement. Because I know for some of you, you go, well, I know that our church is voluntarily affiliated with that organization, but what does that mean? There are some actual beliefs there, but then what does it mean to be a part of the NCC family, the North Crossings Church family? And so we're going to look at that a little bit, and we're going to talk just a little bit about some of what that is. And so the NCC family, maybe you've seen this cross around. This is a cross that we've been working with to kind of build a logo. What is it that we are? We are called to interact with the world, but we're right on the highway, and we're called to drive a highway straight to heaven. And we're called to build a road that's going to get people there. And so we're connected both with God and with the people that are around us. NCC literally is North Crossings Church. NCC. And we use this term family around here to describe who we are. And we are one family, joint heirs with Christ of the kingdom of heaven. And so we're gonna break those down a little bit. When we talk about the NCC family, these are the pinnacles of what we are talking about. If you come into NCC, what we're hoping for is that you will be nurtured. You will be nurtured from wherever you are in life. And that term is described as to care for and encourage the growth and development of God's creation. So God is nurturing you right now. If you have ever called out his name, then he is there for you to connect with, and he will nurture you. He will give you nourishment. He will reach you wherever you are and help you to that next level. And that is a core belief of not just the Church of God, but of NCC. We are a place where people can come and find nurturing. They can be brought up. We are a place of commitment. We are committed to following the ways of Jesus, to the way that he followed God, the way that he talked about the Bible, his commitment to prayer, his commitment to other people, and his commitment to service. And we're going to talk about that. We're going to go deeper with that. But we are people of commitment. We are also a people of charisma. Now, that term, especially in the church, has been hijacked. And usually if we talk about a charismatic congregation, what we're talking about is a congregation that speaks in tongues. Now, the Church of God has a belief in speaking in tongues, and typically we translate the term glossolalia as one in which we are speaking a language that's known within the world. But it is a divine gift. I have been in South America, and I have prayed for that gift, and God did not give it to me. It is not his gift to give. It is not the gift that he chooses to give me. I have prayed to be able to pray with these men and women who came to me to pray for them in their own language, and I'm going, I got English. God, if you give me something else, I want it. But that's what I got. So get out of here. You know, it's about all I can do with it. You know, that was my prayer. It's like, you know, God touched them, and they're going, no habla inglés. And I'm going, no habla español. So we're in the same boat, but we're not able to speak to each other. But charisma, what we're talking about, is a compelling attractiveness or charm that it can inspire devotion in others. And in NCC, at North Crossing Church, we are called to have charisma. We are called to be able to live a life in such a way that other people want what we got. When's the last time someone wanted what you got? Not like Ray, who's had the flu for the last week. We don't want that. And he was gracious. He stayed out of the office all week long. He did not go out in public at all because he wanted to save the rest of society. And that's appreciated. All right, but we're also called to be a family. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. So let's dive a little bit deeper into this. Nurture. Matthew 11, 28, Jesus says these words, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." This goes on to say that I invite you to carry my yoke, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now I want to talk for a minute about what that is. In that day and age, you would typically go and ask the religious leader in your area, "What must I do to inherit the kingdom of God? What must I do to live it out here? What must I do to earn it in the hereafter?" And that was referred to by the local rabbi as his yoke. Now, what was the yoke of Jesus? Because there were some rabbis who said, okay, there's some 500 some odd laws in the Old Testament. If you can name me 50 of them while standing on your head, then you can earn the kingdom of heaven. What? There was a rabbi who, no kidding, said if you can remember 200 and you can recite them while standing on one foot. What? That makes no sense. But the reality is people were dying to know how to get a blessing from God. People wanted that more than anything else. And Jesus comes along and he says, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Pick up my cross and carry it." What is Jesus' cross? He says, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself." That is his yoke. Two laws. Love God and love your neighbor. And of these two things, there is no law against him. And he adds another phrase at the bottom, and he says, in fact, all of the laws and all of the prophets were built on these two. Man, that's way easier for me to memorize. Me, a guy who doesn't memorize verbatim anything. In fact, if you ever hear me quote scripture, you can understand immediately is the Trey edited version. Because I don't have rote memory skills. Rodney's in here. Rodney and I were in high school together. And I can remember being in a play in our art appreciation we were in. And we were supposed to do a play. And I remember like four different times. We only gave this live twice. Once it was to an elementary school in Fisk Union. Another time it was to the high school there. And I remember having to be fed my cue line like four times. Like, oh yeah, I'm supposed to speak. And I never said it the same way any one time. I mean, it was always something different because that's just me. My brain doesn't work that way. In fact, the worship team often laughs at me because you will notice I am staring at the words almost 90% of the times because otherwise you don't know what's going to come out of my mouth. I mean, it could be anything. My heart and my soul, Lord, I give you my heart. I don't remember the words to this song. You know, I mean, that's me. And it's just kind of who I am. And I've learned to live with that, and I'm okay with that. But you give me only two that I got to remember? Man, that's way easier for me. So commit. There's a bunch of things that we're called to be committed to. We're called to be committed to God. In Peter 1, 15 and 16, it says, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. I love how Peter pulls an Old Testament scripture and he goes, and he just rewords it. And he says, this is what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to be holy. Now, I want to help you to understand something because I grew up in the Church of God. I grew up in old school Church of God. And we defined holiness in my youth group growing up is don't drink, cuss, or chew, or date girls that do. That was it. You labeled holiness by the things you didn't do. At the conference Brian was talking about yesterday with Brother Todd Brashler, he talked about how for years holiness has been defined as the things we run from. But we've been really, really poor about giving you sight of what we're running to. And so I want to give you an idea of what that looks like. I want to give you an idea of what it looks like to run to something. So I want you to think for just a moment about how you see God. And I want to challenge you real quick for a moment because most of us, when we think about God, we take the very best attribute of our life, we magnify that by 1,000, and that's who God is, right? My best attribute is that I really, really, really like being around people. So God must love that. And so he just wants to be with everybody at all times. And that's my view of God. Here's the problem with that. I am trying to see God through me. Yes, he created me. Yes, he breathed life into me. But if you can understand God by looking at Trey Oldham, you're not understanding a very grandiose God very well. Right? I'm trying to read him through me. Man, open up the scriptures. Holiness is set apart. So God doesn't look like this world, although he created this world. And he created you and I in his image. What does that mean? He created us to be creators. He created us to be loving and kind and joyful and honest and honorable and humble. And he created us to try to aspire to be like him. So don't take our best attributes and try to be better at those. That's not going to accomplish looking like God. Instead, learn how to cast off the things that weigh us down. All right? I don't know how many of you have ever seen the movie Patch Adams. It's a Robin Williams movie. It came out in the late 80s, early 90s. But there was a quote in there that I really, really loved. There's a point in time where he's standing there and he holds his hands out and he says, what do you see? He was asking a friend, look at my hand, tell me what you see. And he goes, well, I see five fingers. He goes, then that's the problem. You're looking at the problem. Look beyond the problem to the solution. And all of a sudden, the fingers really got blurry and kind of disappeared. And he goes, well, I don't know, there's 10 or 15 fingers, but I can see the back door. I can see the other things on the other side. He goes, then you're finally getting the grasp of this. We spend all of our time looking at life, at the problems that we have, and what we have to learn to do is to look beyond that towards God. And when we can set our focus on Him, we've got a greater opportunity to hit that mark than if we constantly look like this, like, I'm running from sin. You know, I don't know where I'm going if I'm always looking behind me. And I'm going to run into something else. But holiness is about fixing our eyes on Jesus and running towards that, not running away from something. And so when we talk about holiness, when I talk about holiness, every time that's what I'm referring to. What are you running to? Not what are you running from? Okay? Does that clear it up a little bit for you? All right. So we're going to talk also about commitment to the Bible. Now, in all of these five previous sermons and this one, I did not specifically make Bible a one-week series. It's because it laces into every one of them. There has been no part, whether we were talking about the cross, whether we were talking about the altars, whether we were talking about the baptistry, whether we were talking about the back door or the welcome center, there is no part of that that has not been influenced by the Bible. Now, in the Church of God, we don't sign, if you come here with a Baptist background, you're pretty used to having some type of letter that you've signed, a commitment that you've made, and you're assigned that to a local congregation. And I'm not trying to pick on the Southern Baptist way. What I'm trying to do is explain that you won't find that in the Church of God. You won't find that at North Crossings Church. If you want to know what it means to be a member of our church, it has nothing to do with a document. Do you believe that Jesus Christ died for your sins and was raised again? Yes? Do you want to call this place your church home? Yes? Welcome. You're a member. Now, what does it mean to be a voting member? It means you got to be 16 years or older. Sorry, we're all too old to vote. It means you got to be 16 years or older. You have to have worshiped here consecutively for 6 months. And that one can actually be waived for any time we vote. If you are brand new to this church and you go, man, but I'm invested in this place. I want to vote. I want to be a part of the future of this church. Just tell us. That's going to get voted on. More than likely, you're going to be allowed to vote. But if you are living out a Christian life and you call this your church home and you come here regularly and you're over 15 years old, you're 16 years or older, then you're a voting member of this church. That's what membership is. We don't have cards that we care of everybody. We're thinking about the possibility of that. Just that you can go, hey, look where I go. You know, our society is quite used to having affiliations with memberships now. We're a member to the golf course. We're a member to the country club. We're a member to the Monroe Athletic Club or whatever that is. We're a member of the ULM staff, or we're a member of, you know, we're used to having that in our terminology today. That was not accustomed back when the Church of God was founded, and that's a big part of not signing membership, is because we don't want to say that we are part of something that is undefined. And so for us, the only document that we hold up is the Bible. If you can open up that Bible and you can tell me you've done the research, as long as it fits the mold of the Bible, cool. If you've done your research and you've talked to God and you've let Him speak to you, then rock on. We will celebrate where you are walking. Because I'm pretty certain that if you open up the Bible, it's not going to lead you to really ugly places in life. You know, we talk about in the this one isn't a part of my notes, but one of the things we talk about when we talk about the Holy Spirit in this church is there are gifts that God gives us. That was one of the things with God. I forgot to talk about God is triune. That's a really big word, a really weird word that means that we believe that God exists in three personas, three personalities, Father, Son, and Spirit. Can we fully understand or explain that? No, we cannot. But if there's any way to assist in that, you know, I have three different functions in my life. In my life, I am a father, I am a husband, and I am a pastor. When I'm in my pastoral role, I have different functions. I am a counselor. I am a leader. I am a speaker. You know, we all have these varying functions, and the Father was the creator of all, right? The Son, the Spirit, was the Word that God spoke that became flesh and indwelled this earth. And the Holy Spirit is how God continues to interact with our soul here, today, now, forever. And so when we talk about that, the Holy Spirit gives us gifts, right? There are a bunch of different gifts. But one of the things that I am personally believing that we are going to move into as a church, and I know that's a part of our DNA, but I'm about speaking things out. If those gifts are from God, they bring about the fruits of the Spirit. Peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. If they don't bring those things out in you, is it God's Spirit or is it another? Okay? That is one of those discerning tests that we can have. If you're allowing the gifts that God has given you to turn you into someone God wouldn't recognize, we got problems. Okay? But that's who we are. That's the church. This is about introducing myself and introducing you to where we're going and where we've been. So the Bible is imperative. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all scripture is God-breathed and is useful for instruction, for conviction, for correction, and for training in righteousness. The Bible is important to our everyday lives. And we believe that it's something that you should interact with on a daily basis. It's something we should interact with on a daily basis. Does that mean that you need to spend 6 hours a day with the scripture open? Probably not. Your reading scripture is not going to look like mine. I remember I was telling somebody yesterday at this conference we were at, Brother Paul Neimeyer was sitting there. Brother Paul was a great influence in my life. His wife, Sister Gussie, was also a great influence in my life. And I always felt like my prayer life should look like hers, but it didn't. Sister Gussie often spent 3 to 6 hours a day in prayer. And when she went to pray, she went to her prayer chair in her guest room. And in front of her prayer chair, there were two holes in the carpet where her knees had worn holes through the carpet. That's a woman that prayed. And I always felt insufficient because I looked at her prayer life and I was like, but you know what? God has not given me that as my directive. And so I don't want you to look at other people and the way they interact with the Bible or the way they interact with prayer or the way they interact with God and want what they've got. I want you in conversation with God, using the Bible, using prayer, using your time with Him to understand the direction He has for you. Because it's personal. Cool? All right, let's keep moving. Prayer. Hey, we got there anyway. Prayer. 1 John 5:14. This is the confidence we have in approaching God. That if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. That's a pretty cool promise. If you ask it, He'll hear you. What? Do I really pray like that? Do I really pray like God's going to actually hear me? Prayer is a very important part of the Christian life. But here's what prayer has been relegated to. Well, God, in the bulletin, it says that I should be praying for blah, 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 blah. Amen. All right, on with my day. So we're reading our laundry list of needs to God. And that's all we do. Prayer is about talking with God. I don't call my friend up on the phone and go, Hey, Rod, I just want to tell you, I've been thinking about you today. Life's been good. I've been really busy. I hope that school's been going well for you. I hope that things are going well with Vivian. I really like talking to you. Have a great day, man. Love you. Bye. That's not talking. That was me talking at somebody, not talking to them. If I talk to someone, it's not a very good friendship if I don't stop and listen to them as well. When's the last time in your prayer life you said, all right, God, now it's your time to talk? And you just sat and listened. I was given, I consider it a gift, but it was a very troublesome gift that I was given when I was in seminary. One of our assignments for one of my classes was, hey, Trey, I want you to go out and I want you to find a really quiet place and I want you to sit still and not say anything and just listen for God for 45 minutes. And that was the assignment. And I want you to do that every day for 2 weeks. The first time I did that, I went out in the woods behind, I was living with my aunt at the time, and she had 15 acres around her house, and there were woods behind it, and I walked back as far as I could get in the woods, and I sat down, and it was the first time I could remember in a very long time that I got away from all mechanical anything. And the silence was deafening. There was a ringing in my ears that would not stop, and I didn't hear anything other than that ringing. That was it. In the back of my head for 45 minutes, I was like, well, this stunk, you know. All right, God, we'll try it again tomorrow. It's an assignment. So the second day I went out there, and in about 30 minutes, my ears finally adjusted to silence. And I began to hear more of the leaves shifting, the twigs moving, the wind blowing through the trees. And I was like, well, you know what? That was a cooler day. That was a lot cooler because I began to, you know, at least connect with nature, you know. Day three, by about 5 minutes, I was hearing things. And about 30 minutes into my quiet time of not saying anything, I began to see God at work. I began to recognize the things that were going on around me where God was invested. You know, this frog that just jumped over here, that's not by accident. God's in his life, too. Oh, that bird, man, there was no reason on earth that bird is so pretty. But God just put it that way so that I could enjoy it. And before long, by day 5, 6, 7, my mind began to run with thoughts of greatness of God. And I began to feel like those questions that I always carry with me, hey, God, how can I honor you with this? Or how can I honor you with this? What do I need to do here? I began to feel like clarity was coming in some of those things. Now, they were not just because I chose to be silent. But they happened because I began to believe that I could hear from God. And so if you've not done something like that before in your life, or if you've done it, but it's been a long time, that's a challenge to you. Learn to pray, also listening for God. Just invite him to speak back. Because otherwise, it is a monologue, not a prayer. Is that cool? So, but prayer is an important part. We are committed to each other. Matthew 22, 37 through 40, I referenced this a while ago. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. We are committed to serving one another. Now, who is our neighbor? This was a big question for Jesus. Who is your neighbor? And he goes on to share a story that is called, in most Bibles, the prodigal son. Not the prodigal son, sorry. Called this Good Samaritan. Thank you, Amy. My wife finishing my sentence for me where I cannot get there. The Good Samaritan. I actually like to refer to this as the gullible Samaritan. First of all, it's a Samaritan. By every Jewish understanding, this is the people we hate. This is the people who they believe that the right place to serve God, the right way to follow him, is over on Mount Horeb over here. And if you really are a Christian, you're going to be over here doing it this way. But we know, because we're Israelites, because we're Jewish, really it's supposed to be in Jerusalem. And for centuries, these two people have hated the way each other serve God. Let me say that again. They have hated the way that each other serve God. But it has been ingrained in them to hate one another. So if I walked in here and I called you, yeah, man, you are just one bad Samaritan. I mean, that's like the worst insult that I could throw down. You know, that's worse than making fun of your mama. I mean, that's bad. It's really hurtful, and I am really making fun of you. And so Scott, you Samaritan, you know. But when it comes down to it, that's like calling you someone who serves God a different way. But they were still serving Yahweh. That's the crazy thing. They were still serving God. They were just part of those tribes that didn't identify with Jerusalem because of a difference between brothers 1,000 years ago. It's crazy. Crazy, but it's part of the story. And so when he talks about neighbors, he says, there's this Samaritan, that guy that you wouldn't trust with anything. But here's the thing, a Samaritan is still Middle Eastern and still looks just like anybody else if they're not wearing the same, if they would put on the same clothes that you wear, they would look just like you. And so the Samaritan comes up on someone who's been beaten and robbed and stripped of all their clothing. Now, two Middle Eastern men walking down through there, and if one of them is not wearing their specific color royal robes, there is no way to distinguish who that is. So this statement of this Samaritan walking up, this person that we would hate just because of who they are, they walk up on the scene of an accident, and in this accident, there is no way to discern whether that person is from Arkansas or Louisiana. But all of a sudden, he stops and he goes, hey, I don't care. I don't care where he's from. I don't care where he worships. I don't care anything about him. There is a person that is hurt and dying, and I'm going to go help them. Now, there's significant happenings with these other two people that pass by, and I don't want the symbolism to get lost on you. There was a Levite and a priest that walked by. Now, their religious laws prevented them from touching a dead body, and the person was off the trail, so they couldn't tell if they were alive or dead. And if they had touched a dead body, they would not be allowed to go in and worship. So they passed by for good reason in their eyes, but Jesus said it's not good enough. So they pass by, and this Samaritan drops by, and this Samaritan does the unthinkable. He throws this nearly dead guy on his mule, carries him to town, drops him off, because there are no hospitals in that day, drops him off at a local hotel, and says, hey, whatever he needs, I need you to tend to him. Here's 3 weeks' worth of wages I'm paying for, so that you can go in and check on him pretty regularly. And if you need more money, you just call me and let me know. And I'm going to send it to you. Now, that's not good. That's gullible. Right? But that's what Jesus calls us to. That's what serving others is. It is sacrificial. It is, hey guys, I'm going to choose not to have milk and bread this week so that somebody else who needs it can have milk and bread this week. Because you know what? I'll get paid on Friday and I can have milk and bread. But here's that out of my house. You know, we are called to serve one another, and that is very important to me. One of the things you're going to find out really quickly about me as the pastor is, this is something I'm going to harp on. You know, this little bitty test of sticking out these cards out in the entryway to help families in need, oh, that's just the tip of the iceberg. I only put about $1,000 worth of items out there that you could take away and you can invest. I know that there's people in here, including myself, that if it came down to it, I could write a $1,000 check and not miss it. So me putting $1,000 of a pendant of gifts to give away out there, that's nothing. We'll do more than that. Not this year, because I want you to get into it slowly. You know, how do you boil a frog? Slowly. Otherwise he jumps out of the pot, right? And so that we are going to become people that transform the community around us. I've asked this 3 weeks straight in a row. If this church disappeared, would our community even notice? We're going to become a church where this community would notice if we were gone. Because that's who God called us to be. People of change. Service. How did I get there from each other? That's okay. We walked straight through it. I went through it anyway. Charisma. I don't know why I have Hebrews 3:15. It's not Hebrews. It's 1 Peter, but it's the right scripture. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. This scripture makes an assumption that we are living out hope in such a way that people are walking up and going, what is different about you? When's the last time a person just walked up and goes, hey, we'll pick on my wife, she's easy, she's sitting there, Amy, there is something different about you. I need to know what you got because I want some of that. Whether it's drugs, whether it's medicine, whether it's alcohol, whatever you got, I want some of that because you live life to the fullest. When's the last time somebody asked you that question? Because that's what the vision of the church of Christ is about. Peter, who was really, really close to God, really, really close to Jesus, said, we're supposed to live a life where people just walk up out of the blue and go, what's up with you? Because I want whatever you're having. We're called to live a life of extreme joy, of extreme hope, of extreme love. And when I look around most churches, I see extreme punishment.
I had to get up and go to church again this morning because it's what I'm supposed to do.
I'd much rather be out. I'd be in bed if I could be, if I had a choice. If my mom hadn't drugged me to church, I'd be in bed this morning. You know, sleeping off last night's fun. Greg, I'd rather be fishing. He's my stepdad. I can do that to him. He'll spank me later. Ray, I'd rather be hunting. You know, one of my ladies in the last church I was at would rather be sowing than anything else on earth. And so, you know, whatever it is, you know, don't look like you just lost your best friend when you come to church. Look like you're coming to worship the God who created you for love. Enjoy it. I know our worship team would really, really appreciate people singing like God was something that was awesome. How great thou art, how great thou art, then sings my soul. You know, I grew up,
it's hard to do this sometimes, being here, because you all know what church I grew up in, and you know people that go to that church.
But I can remember as a kid sitting in church, sitting on the pew singing, stand up for Jesus, you soldiers of the cross. What? You can't do that. You guys, I mean, this should be a place that you come excited. This is the place where you come to encourage people. This is the place where you come to get encouraged. And we often walk in like we're miserable. We're a place of hope. We are a place of love. Lastly, we are a place of family. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in His sufferings in order that we may also share in His glory. Jesus is your brother.
You are his sister. You are his brother. You are his friend. And that means we get the same inheritance that he does. There is a kingdom with more riches than you've ever seen. There is a kingdom with more love than you've ever felt. There is a kingdom with more than you can even imagine. And you get it. You get it. The keys were handed over the day that you knelt at an altar. Here you go. And that's what family is. So we don't give up on family, even when they make us mad. They're not out of the family just because they don't show up for 2 or 3 weeks to church on a Sunday. You know, they're not out of the family just because they don't think the way that we think all the times. They are still our brother and sister. And we are still called to love them. And that is what the NCC family is called to be. So the great thing is I said a lot of this like you're not already halfway there. As a church, we're way over halfway there. But when you ask me to be up here on a regular basis and to sit in an office each week and to dream about where God is carrying us, you may or may not have known what you were getting yourself into, but I'm trying to give you a glimpse. So, how do we become the church God made us to be? We have to envision who he has called us to be. We're not yet called to figure out how we're going to do it. All right? Those steps will come as God guides us. But first, are we being who he called us to be? What does surrendering all we are and all we have to him look like? I want you to begin to dream that. I want you to begin to think that. I want you to begin to ask yourself, what does it look like if I give up everything I have? I shared a couple of weeks ago, actually it was on a Wednesday night, but there was a time in my life just a few years ago that God asked me to do probably the dumbest thing he's asked me to do in my life. I had, at that point in time, I had a 3.5-year-old and I had a baby in the house with me. And I talked to my wife and we moved a homeless man in with us. Now that is stupid. Don't ever do that unless God tells you to do it. And God will, if God tells you to do it, he's going to tell the person that lives with you to do it too. I would never have done it if my wife had not go, yep, I think you're right, Trey, that's what we're supposed to do. We moved Mitch in on Christmas Day, and on the 26th of December, the day after, we loaded up in our minivan and we drove to Louisiana for a week and left him our house and our other vehicle. We were dumb. Oh, we were dumb. We were gullible. We were the gullible Samaritans. Now, I wish I could stand up here and go, that made all the difference in Mitch's life. Here's the thing. 1 month later, Mitch left in the middle of the night, and I've not ever seen him since. I don't know what that did for Mitch, but I know what it did for me. It reminded me that everything I've ever been given in life is to be used by God for something. I don't know what it is yet, but I can promise you I'm no longer attached to stuff. If you need it, you got it. Just tell me. Me and Amy will figure out a way to make it work without it. We've done it so far. So what does it look like if you surrender all you are and all you have to Christ? All right. That's all I got, and I went way longer than I'm supposed to today. My apologies. So this is what we're going to do. Instead of a long, drawn-out altar time, which I often offer, and so seldom gets responded to, that's okay. You'll learn and I'll learn. I'm going to give us a closing prayer. But in that closing prayer, I'm going to give it 60 seconds of silence for you to hear from God. 60 seconds of silence. So you remember that when it feels like 17 minutes. It's not. But I'm going to open us in prayer. I'm going to give us 60 seconds of silence. And then I'm going to come back and close us in prayer. And you'll be dismissed. Well, not quite. Kenny's got some announcements he's going to make. But other than that, all right? Father God, thank you for reminding us of who you are. Thank you for the opportunity to engage your people for this little while. And Father, I pray that something in all the garbled mess that I threw out there today, something leads people to transformation. Father, I don't want to be a dispenser of information. I want to be the host of transformation for you. So, Father, nurture us so that we may nurture those around us. Thank you for your commitment to us, and may we share that commitment with the world around us as we love you, as we love others, as we live it out. Father, we thank you for the charisma that you have exuded that has drawn us to you, and may we be ambassadors of that same charisma. And Father, thank you for calling us your sons and daughters before we even knew who you were. And so, Father, we pause for this minute. May we hear from you. May you give us grace, love, compassion, guidance. May you speak into our nurturing, into our commitment, and into our charisma. Thank you, God. Amen. Brother Kenny.
Share just a few announcements. I'm going to try to do this in date order. I don't know that I'll manage that since I didn't number them. But, there I go. We got children's Christmas presentation first. So I guess I'll start with that one. Next Sunday morning, December the 17th, I promise you, you won't want to miss it. If you haven't been around and saw some of the creativity that Becky does with this children's program, you'll be a little surprised and amazed and enjoy it thoroughly. So come next Sunday and be prepared to be blessed with the Christmas presentation. Wednesday night, there is a parents' meeting after the service. This is with all of the youth. Matt is going to have a parents' meeting to discuss the fundraising events and the convention that they'll be going to this summer, and needs your help in getting all that prepared and planned. So be here Wednesday night in preparation for that meeting after the service. Saturday in Anagrano Park, there is a get-together sponsored by the First Baptist Church in downtown Monroe. Anagrano Park is across the street from the hospital, St. Francis. And that will be a time where there will be a live nativity scene, train rides, cookie decorating, and all types of different fun. So if you're looking for something to do next Saturday afternoon, early evening, run down to Anagrano Park across from St. Francis Hospital. Be a great time and a great event to celebrate Christmas. And then coming up December the 24th, we will be having our annual Christmas Eve candlelight service and communion. This event will last approximately an hour, maybe a little bit less than an hour, and encourage you and your family, your guests, your relatives, your neighbors, your enemies, whoever you'd like to bring them to our communion service and candlelight service that Sunday evening. Any other announcements this morning? Oh, I did forget, didn't I, Dana? Thursday night, the ladies will be getting together at Sister Dana's home, whether she's there or not, and they'll get together and have their celebration and party. And don't forget your gift. The instructions for that are in the bulletin also. And hey, while you're doing it, you might as well pray for Ray and Dana, since they're going to go and leave Wednesday morning. And Ray will have his sinus surgery Wednesday, and then they'll be coming back either Wednesday evening or Thursday morning, more than likely Thursday morning, and take care of all of that too. Be praying for them as they travel. Any others? God is good.
All the time.
All the time. Thank you for being